Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, good morning, all of you. Today, we are going to learn the new important topic, that is snake poisoning. This snake poisoning topic is again you are going to learn in medicine department also. So, today, we will see what are the types of the snakes. How you are going to recognize which is poisonous, which is non-poisonous, and after you are confirming that if the poisonous or non-poisonous snake, then what type of the treatment you are going to give as per is it poisonous or is it non-poisonous, and what are the different myths about the snake poisoning. So it's a very interesting lecture. Again, I am saying that it's very important related to your short-term goal as well as the long-term goal. Short-term goal that you have to pass the second year MBBS examination, and many times full question is asked on a snake poisoning. There is always one question, full question on toxicology, and many times on snake poisoning, full question or short note on anti-snake venom has been asked. So please make this topic thoroughly for your short-term goal and long-term goal as a clinician, as a medical officer, or as a medical practitioner. You are going to come across the cases of a snake poisoning. So your concept should be clear. Is it poisonous snake or is it non-poisonous snake? Because the treatment of the snake poisoning is the giving the anti-snake venom. And anti-snake venom itself can cause an anaphylactic reaction. So if you are confident it's the non-poisonous snake, then you can only reassure them and watch for 24 hours. That is the treatment for the non-poisoning case. But if you are not able to identify, is it poisonous snake or non-poisonous snake? And if you are blindly going to give the anti-snake venom, so with your treatment, if it is the non-poisonous and you are giving the anti-snake venom, and unfortunately that person had an anaphylactic shock, then the patient may die, and a case of a negligence may file against you. So for that reason, your concept, how to differentiate, is it poisonous snake or non-poisonous? With this lecture, if you listen it carefully, it's very easy how to find out is it poisonous snake or non-poisonous snake. Then your concept will get clear. So with this small introduction, I'm starting my topic, that is about the snake poisoning. There are about 3,500 known species of the snake all over the world. And remember that only 350 species are venomous all over the world. But in India, only 4 species, important species, are the poisonous. Otherwise, all are non-poisonous. So remember this, that most of the snakes are the non-poisonous one. So the figure tells that 3,500 cases are non-venomous. Why? Out of these 350 are venomous all over the world, and India only 4 to 5 types are the only venomous. And among non-venomous, which is the dangerous, that is python. The snake is divided into head, trunk and tail. The head may be oval, triangular or the same width as a trunk, ending as a blunt snout. The head bears 2 eyes, 2 nostrils, mouth, external ears are absent. So I'm going to tell you myth, but time being, you remember that snake doesn't have the external ears, but he can only perceive the vibration on the ground. And with that vibration, it can catch its prey. It can catch its prey. So classification of the snakes are mainly divided into 5: Colubridae, Atractae, Spiridae, Elapidae, Viperidae and Hydrophidae. In important is the Elapidae, and in that cobras, crates, coral snake are there. Viperidae is that of the viper is there, and hydrophidi is that of the sea snake. And colubridi, that is the eastern part, that are the parrot snake, rat snake, wandering gator snake. Atractaspididae is the in African and Middle Eastern burrowing of stiletto snakes, also known as the burrowing or mole vipers or adders. But for your, as a UG student, remember important are elapidae, that in elapidae consist of cobras, great coral snake, viperidae consist of the viper snake, and hydrophidae, that is the sea snakes. The WHO classification of Indian snakes of a medical importance. Class 1, commonly cause death or serious disability. What are they? They are cobras, Russell viper, and saw scale viper. That is class 1. In class 1, it includes cobra, Russell viper, and saw scale viper. And class 2 is the uncommonly caused bites but are recorded to cause serious effect, that are great king cobra. And third is commonly caused bite but serious effects are very uncommon. So only these three types, that the class first consist of commonly caused death or serious disability. In this consist of cobra, Russell viper, and saw scale viper. And uncommonly causes bite but are recorded to cause serious effects are the crate and king cobra. Actually, the viva question is, which is the most poisonous snake? The most poisonous snake is crate, because in a single bite, it whatever the weapon, whatever the poison it injects in a body, the is small quantity, fatal dose is very small. So that crate is the most poisonous snake. But many times student tell that king cobra or cobra is the most poisonous snake. That is wrong answer. Correct answer is that the crate is the most poisonous snake. So class 1, commonly cause death or serious disability. Class 2, uncommonly cause bites but are recorded to cause serious effects. And class 3, commonly cause bites but serious effects are very uncommon. Features indicative of a venomous snake. It is very that usually dull color, that is brown, black, gray, dull green, etc. Important point, because in myths we are going to see the difference. So usually poisonous snakes are the dull color, that is brown, black colored, gray, dull green. Stout body with abruptly tapering tail or compressed tail. So body is stout and compressed tail is there. Broad belly scale extended across entire width of the belly. So it's very important differentiating point. From that only you are able to differentiate that the it is poisonous snake. So when you see the part which is in a contact with the surface or with the earth, so that part or the part of a snake which is in contact with the ground, that part is known as the posterior part, and the part which faces to the skin is that of the ventral. So that part which touches to the ground, there are the scales which extends all over the entire belly. So that is most important point. Small scales are on triangular head, pit between eye and nostril, presence of hood in case of the cobra, presence of fangs. It is also important in the non-poisonous snake. No poison, no fangs are there. There are teeth is present, different. But fangs are only present that in a poisonous snake, and two fangs are there. Presence of rattle at the end of the tail. But the important point now is the theory. Now I am showing you the then the photograph. With this, you are able to differentiate which is poisonous snake and which is non-poisonous snake. So the first, what the part A, you concentrate on the A, where I have shown the arrow, that the belly or the part which is with contact with the ground, the scales are entire. That through and there is no abruption or there is no cut. It's the through and through scales are there. If this is through and through scales, the part which is the touching to the ground, then you can say definitely it is the poisonous snake. Tail here, there is the division is present and tail is down. Now you can see the head. Head is of two types. If the scales are smaller one, then it is of a viper type. Triangular and square. That is the C part. This is the C part. And here the head is triangular and scales are smaller one. So that is viper. And D is that the large scale. If the large scale, then it is of a two types. Either it is crate or either it is the cobra. Then how to differentiate between crate and cobra? In cobra, there is hood is present and spectacle mark is present. Another differentiating point that is shown in E, that is the third infralabial is the largest and it touches to the nostril and the eye. So that is the differentiating point and it is the classical feature of the cobra. And same thing here, that the fourth infralabial is the largest. So the largest in case of the poisonous snake. And the most important differentiating point, either it is cobra or either it is crane, that the ventral scale, which is facing towards the sky, that scale, if the middle row shows the hexagonal appearance. So see the look at the arrow. If these are the hexagonal one, then it is the crate. Now again, I will tell you how to differentiate between the poisonous snake and the non-poisonous snake. The most important feature to differentiate, is it poisonous snake or is it non-poisonous snake? And that is the, I have shown in a figure A. So in A, what the surface or the portion of a snake or that which is touching to the ground, that is also known as a ventral scale, and it are through and through. It is the scales are the, so usually stout body with abruptly trapped and compressed, and the broad belly scale extending across entire width of the belly. See the point number 3. So this point number 3 is shown in the A, that the scales are entire throughout the belly. So with this you are confirmed only with this feature that it is poisonous snake. So then there are different types of the poisonous snake. What are they? 4 important poisonous snake in India, that is cobra, crane, viper. Viper is again divided into the saw-scaled viper and Russell's viper. We are going to see each snake in detail, but time being, remember this. So now you have confirmed it is the poisonous snake. Then you want to differentiate, is it viper or is it crate or cobra? Because crate and cobra are neurotoxic, while viper is vasculotoxic. If then you are going to concentrate on the head. If the head is the triangular and small scales are there, then it is the viper. Then viper is again divided into the saw-scaled viper and the Russell's viper. How to differentiate? I will tell. Now only concentrate that it is viper. Is it viper or is it the crate or cobra? If the head scales are smaller one, then it is from a viper family. If the scales are of a larger scale, then it is either it is crate or either it is cobra. So how to differentiate? Is it cobra or is it crate? Then concentrate on a dorsal belly or the that in a G. What G here, the central row are hexagonal. If the central row, which surface? The surface which is facing towards the sky, and it is also known as the dorsal scale. So ventral scales are through and through, means it poisonous. And in a dorsal scale, if the middle row is that of hexagonal, then it is the crate one. And then remains the cobra. If it is not hexagonal, then it is cobra. And the other differentiating feature of a cobra, that it is there is the spectacle mark is there. And another to differentiate, that the third supralabial, that is shown in E, is the largest in a cobra. And also the fourth infralabial, which is shown in a F. That is the largest. So with this differentiating point, you can easily differentiate, is it poisonous or is it non-poisonous? If it is poisonous, then either it belongs to Viperidae family or the Elapidae family. Viperidae family, there are again that either it is saw-scaled viper or that of the Russell viper. How to differentiate? Is it viper? If it, the triangular one and small scale, it is viper. If the head scales are larger one, then it is either crate or either cobra. How to differentiate between crate and cobra? If the ventral surface, that which is touching to the ground, if it is the scale sand through and through throughout the belly, then it is the poisonous snake. Then if a ventral scale, that is dorsal scale, which are facing towards the sky, if the central row is the hexagonal, then it is of a crate. And if it is no hexagonal, then it is cobra. And another differentiating point between crate and cobra, that usually spectacle mark or hood mark, and cobra has its hood with a spectacle mark. So if it is present, then it is cobra. If it is not, then it is the feature of a hood and spectacle scene is easy when the snake is dead. Because in a live snake, we cannot touch and see the spectacle is there and otherwise. So which is differentiating point? From a longer distance, you can see if the dorsal surface which is facing towards the sky, if it is hexagonal, then it is crate. If it is not hexagonal, then it is cobra. And another differentiating point, that the spectacle mark is present in a cobra. And other differentiating mark, that is the third, that is in E, the third supralabial is large and fourth infralabial large. With this figure, it's a very important figure. You can take a screenshot of it. So with this, you can easily differentiate, is it poisonous or non-poisonous. If you are confirmed that it is poisonous, then either it is viper or either it is cobra or crate. With seeing dorsal scale, then if it is hexagonal, then it is crate. Seeing the head, spectacle mark, third supralabial large, fourth infralabial, then it is cobra. So with this, you can easily differentiate that is it poisonous or non-poisonous. If it is poisonous, then it is viper or crate or cobra. In viper also, is it Russell viper or that of the saw-scaled viper. So is it clear your concept? It's very important slide of this lecture. Then common cobra, then you can see the hood as well as the spectacle mark. And you can, if you easily see the picture, there is no hexagonal central row. So it is also named Naja Naja. Other common names are Indian cobra, geographical distribution all year India. Physical appearance, the common cobra is usually brown or black in color, and it is 5 to 6 feet in length. And on dorsal side of the hood, there may be a monocelate or binocelate spectacle mark may present or may not present. If it is present, then it is the differentiating point. So that are the features of the common cobra. Next, common crate. You can see the crate. The scientific name is the name Bungerus caerulus. Other name is the Indian crate. Geographical distribution all year India. Then crate is teal blue snake. And what is the color of this? It is the brown or black in color. While common crate is teal blue snake and up to 3 to 4 feet with whitish band or half ring throughout its back. The most distinctive feature comprises following a chain of a hexagonal large scale throughout the mid dorsal aspect. I already told the subcaudals are undivided and the fourth infralabial skin is the largest in case of a crate. While in case of the common cobra, the third supralabial, that is E, third supralabial is the largest. So that is common cobra. How to differentiate between common cobra and common crate? Next is the saw-scaled viper. So scientific other name is the fursa. Why fursa? Because it makes the vise. The saw-scaled viper is a small snake, only 1.5 to 2 feet long. There is wavy white line along the entire length, each flank, while diamond-shaped marking, that is again distinct, diamond-shaped marking, you can see in a picture throughout its back. And number is 25 to 30. The head is triangular with small scale. A characteristic white arrow-shaped crow foot mark is often present on the head and the pupils are vertical. And why it is called as a saw-scaled viper? Because its lateral side, the scales are serrated. So serrated means it look like a saw. That's why its name is a saw scale shaper. So in a first slide we have seen, if the head is small, triangular with a small scale, then it is viper. Then how to differentiate it is saw scale viper or that of the Russell's viper? Differentiating point is the last point, that its scales are serrated. So at the lateral side, the scales are serrated like a saw. So it is known as a saw scale viper. And the another difference is that on a head, there is the arrow shape or crow foot mark is often present. So with these two distinguishing features, you can easily differentiate either it is saw scale viper or either it is the Russell's viper. Then what is the differentiating point of a Russell's viper? Though Russell's viper, scientific name is Vipera russelli or Davoea russelli. This is brownish stout snake growing up to several feet in the length, and head is triangular with V-shaped mark. While in a saw scale viper, what is the mark? Mark is arrow shaped or crow foot. If crow foot or arrow shaped mark, then it is, and the margins are serrated, then it is saw scale viper. But on a head, if V-shaped mark, then it is a Russell. Then fangs are long, channelized, and hinged, being erected the time of the striking. There are three rows of a chain dark spot. So here is specific three rows are present in a Russell's viper. While in a saw scale viper, the entire length is with the diamond shape marking. While in a Russell's viper, only three rows are there. So that is again the differentiating point. So head mark in a saw scale viper is that a crow foot mark or that of the arrow shape mark in saw scale. While in a Russell's, it's a V-shaped mark. And only three chain dark spots are present on a dorsal surface. The Russell's viper is also hiss loudly when agitated. So it is known as a fursa. Understood? So these are the again is the very important slide, that is how to differentiate between common cobra, king cobra, common crate, banded crate, Russell's viper. So head would present bears a double single spectacle mark, king cobra, head without spectacle mark, common crate, head curved with a large scale, head curved with a large scale, while in a Russell's viper, that is the flank and V shaped mark is there. Belly smooth scale. Important about the color, common cobra brown black, while king cobra yellow green, common crate steel blue, branded crate as that of the same, that is steel blue, while Russell's viper is brown black. The length 1.52 meter in common cobra, king cobra 3 to 4 meter, while common crate is 1.25 to 1.5 meter, branded crate 2 meter, while that of Russell's viper up to 1.5. And common cobra throughout India, while king cobra only in jungles and forests, common crate as so in common human dealing, while branded crate is in Assam, Bengal or South India, and Russell's viper is throughout the India. These are the features of a common poisonous snake in India. Clinical features of a non-venomous snake. A significant proportion of the snake bite is said to be due to non-venomous snake. So remember this point. So consider that the rule that it is the non-venomous only. First, if that patient's relative has brought the snake to the casualty in a bottle, if it is dead, then you can easily see. If the that belly touching to the ground, that is belly is known as a ventral belly, and the scales are through and through, means there is no branches. So if the scales are the through and through, then it is the poisonous snake. So this slide A, if it's through and through, it is poisonous snake. If it is not through and through, then it is non-poisonous snake. So what are the features of a non-poisonous? Most of the bites are the non-poisonous. As a result of the fear and apprehension associated with the snake, many times the patient may die with a vagal shock in a serious case. So what is important? Reassurance that it is the non-poisonous snake and you are not going to die. If the non-poisonous, tell him, assure him, give the assurance and watch for 24 hours. Till that, you can start IV line, put some vitamin, that is the vitamin vial in that, so that the person also treatment has started for his psychological. Actually, no role of that, but only for the psychological reassurance, and watch for urine output. Only that thing you have to do in a non-poisonous snake. Understood? And most important, psychological support, reassurance should be there. So that's the very important. Your communication skill must be good so that you can reassure us that is the non-poisonous snake and nothing is going to happen with you. We are only going to watch you for 24 hours. Your urine will pour, and don't sleep with the awake. So that is the treatment of a non-venomous snake. So most of the time with a vagal shock only the patient dies. So what are the types of the dry bite? The snake never is first bite. Remember my friends, don't kill the snake when you see, because they are our friends. Understood? So and they never in their first bite ingest the poison. Only if you irritate them or other thing, then and then only their bite becomes the poisonous one. So what are the types of bite? Dry bite. A snake does not always inject venom at the time of biting. Remember this sentence. Protective gear. Second, then many times you want to protect itself from the human being. So other bites are the protective bite, and in that protective bite also it does not inject the poison. Understood? So the venom does not inject the venom in a protective bite also. And that person has covered with a shoes or other cloth, then also if the small amount of the venom is there, it does not go in the body. Understood? So that is the protective. Leakage of the venom may occur. Head-on bites often result in the efficient injection of the venom, while side wipes may cause some venom. That is the leakage of the venom. And the another bite is the superficial bite. Since humans do not constitute normal prey for the most venomous snake, they bite only to defend themselves before making a quick get away. Remember this sentence. So that is the superficial bite is there. In such instances, the snake often deliberately does not bite deeply, but instead only strikes superficially, thereby conserving a precious venom for its genuine prey. Remember, we only think that we are very clever, as a human being, but these animals also have their tendency that not to kill anybody, only they want to protect themselves. That's why their first bite is superficial bite. And already that my last sentence, that the snake openly deliberately does not bite deeply, but instead of only strike superficially, and they conserve their venom for their genuine prey. So remember that. So snake can think like that way. So also we can also don't kill the snake. When there is snake, you can call the snake friend, and these people are professional people. They only catch and they take it to the forest. So that the types of snake bite. Systemic effect. So the important snake, that is the crake and cobra, or neurotoxicity, is the dominant clinical feature of elephant bite, that is the cobra bite and the crake bite. In cobra bite, the symptoms comes within 15 minutes to half an hour, while for crake bite it takes several hours. Pre-paralytic stage. There are two stages, pre-paralytic and paralytic stage. What are the symptoms of pre-paralytic? Vomiting, ptosis, blood vision, external ophthalmoplegia, paresthesia, hyperacusis, hypersalivation. That is pre-paralytic stage. And in a paralytic stage, the facial muscle, palate, jaw, tongue, vocal, all muscle get paralyzed. And lastly, respiratory muscle gets paralyzed, and the person is not able to take the breath. And due to this paralysis, the death occurs due to the respiratory arrest. So these are the important stages of the pre-paralytic. That is vomiting, ptosis, blood vision, hypersalivation, that is pre-paralytic. And in the paralytic stage, all muscle get paralyzed. That is start from facial muscle, then palate, jaw, tongue, vocal cord, neck muscle, muscles of deglutition, and primarily all the placid muscle gets paralyzed. Piperide bite is the vasculotoxic, while that of the neurotoxic bite is of a cobra and crane. While viper is the neurotoxic. What are the stages? First appears swelling at the bite site. Then blisters begin to appear about 12 hours in around the site. Then raise intracompartmental pressure at that site. And lastly, the dangerous effect, that is the hemostatic abnormality. The first evidence is persistent bleeding from the bite site. Hematuria may be present. Gingival bleeding occurs, followed by epistaxis, hemoptysis, hematemesis, intracranial or subconjunctival fissure, bleeding from floor of the mouth, tympanic membrane, gastrointestinal tract, and genitorium. And you have learned one poison, that is sui poison. So in that is rathi seeds. If that are injected in an animal, it gives the features of that of the viper bite. What are the viper bite features? That swelling, blister, intra-compartmental pressure, then hemostatic abnormality, and lastly gangrene of that part occurs, and the patient dies lastly with the DIC. So that is the effect of the viperide bite. How the diagnosis of the snake bite? By fang marks. Two puncture wound marks are present. So 8 mm to 4 cm distance between two puncture marks. So you have to see carefully two puncture marks. In addition, non-poisonous snake, maybe in a wolf snake, these fang marks are present. Usually, fang marks are present only poisonous snake. While the half oval mark, that is teeth marks, all the teeth marks are present, that is the feature of a non-poisonous. Only two fang marks, that is the feature of the poisonous mark. Identification of the snake, I already told that it is usually mentioned early that it is attempted where if the victim or his relative has bring them the dead snake, then and only, or with any relative will tell the features from that you can recognize or diagnose the snake bite. Extreme caution, remember, is imperative if the snake is live. So record of the kill snake bite, in-play replace or being handled. Sometimes there are some instances are like that. Then you have to do the laboratory investigation like blood, BTCT, that is bleeding time, clotting time, and urinary output. So these are the primary things you have to do. So what are first aid measures? Verbal assurance, I already said, reassurance, immobilization of part, so you can give the split. Beverages, that many times the people used to give the coffee, so don't give the coffee. Tourniquet should be applied such a way that it only occludes the lymphatic. If it is tightened so much, then instead of giving the treatment, it can cause the gangrene. So no blood supply to. So if you are occluded veins also and arteries also, no blood supply to the peripheral part. So gangrene may occur. So it should be applied such a way that only superficially lymphatics must get cut. Then incision and suction. In many pictures you have seen that lady get a snake bite, then hero comes and sucks her poison, that's bite. Don't do, that's not at all the treatment. And that even that person will get poison. So the victim is also get harm, but the person who is sucking or doing hirogiri also get the poison. So don't do this incision and suction. Also don't apply cryotherapy. That is the cryotherapy means they can apply ice. So don't apply. Then in some instances, no treatment, electric shock, 25 kV, 1 mA can be given for the 10 second intervals. And antipyretics or antiemetics can be given. Most important treatment is the hospital measure. Observe every case of alleged snake bite for minimum 24 hours. Monitor respiratory rate, pulse rate, BP, urine output. And this is very important, anti-venom therapy, the anti-snake venom, which is available in the market in a powder form. You have to make it a liquid form. It's important Viva question. What is ASV? Your answer should be anti-snake venom. What physical form it is present in a market? It present in a powder form. You have to make in a liquid form by adding distilled water or normal saline. Then shake it. After shaking, if the color or that solution is the clear, then only you have to inject it. Otherwise, if it is turbid, then discard it. It is not at all useful. Understood? So if it is turbid, no, it is not potent and should be discarded. So in India, the antivenom is the polyvalent. So it is applicable to arsenic, that is common cobra, common crate, Russell viper, saskin. Where it is present? In Hyderabad, Central Research Institute, Kasuli. Then Bharat Serum and Vaccine Limited, Mumbai. Serum Institute of India, Pune. Hapkin Biopharmaceuticals in Mumbai. So in this institute, actually the bites to the horses are there, then that antigen antibody, and from that, this anti-snake venom is prepared from this, the Hyderabad, Mumbai, Serum Institute, Pune, Hapkin Institute, Mumbai, etc. No need to carry out hypersensitivity test, because you have to give, even if with the hypersensitivity test, antibiotic shock is there. In many books it is given that you have to give the carry out hypersensitivity, but now recently it is not advisable, because that's the only one treatment is available, and you have to give that treatment to the patient. So don't do the hypersensitivity, directly inject. And how it is? Two methods: IV injection, 2 ml minute, and IV infusion, directly IV infusion, or 5 to 10 ml in a isotonic fluid per kg body weight. So directly IV, or you can give IV infusion by adding it 5 to 10 ml in the isotonic center, that is NS. And what is it? Just 5 to 10 ml. For hemotoxic and neurotoxic inhibition, less than 3 hours, 10 vials are given. And same hemotoxic and neurotoxic inhibition, if it is more than 3 hours since the bite, 7 vials of the anti-snake venom. All these again will be repeated in your medicine, this one. But the question comes, then you have to write polyvalent. It is applicable, or it is effective in common cobra, common crate, Russell viper, saskin. Where it is prepared? That is the VINS byproduct, Hyderabad, Central Research Institute, Kasuli, Bharat Serum, Mumbai, Serum Institute, India, Pune, Hapkin Institute, Mumbai. Don't do the this one. Hypersensitivity. How it is injected? By 2 meter, directly IV injected 2 ml per minute, or intravenous infusion 5 to 10 ml added in isotonic per kg body weight. If the snake bite is of less 3 hours, the 10 vials of ASV is according to slowly given. If it is more than 3 hours, then 7 vials is of anti-snake venoms are administration. What are forensic issues in the snake bite? Even today that it is worshipped in a Nag Panchami as a god. Almost all the snake bites are accidental, but there are instances that the suicidal and homicidal, that Leopatra is the suicidal snake bite is there. Then deaths due to snake bite are regarded as a medical legal nature in India. So always there is a postmortem examination is suggested in a snake bite. But unfortunately, you cannot clear cut science of the animation. Even the fang marks, which are the characteristic or diagnostic point of the snake bite, are may not always the visible. Then how it is diagnosed? Immunodiagnosis with the help of ELISA makes it possible to conclude diagnose death due to the snake bite by analyzing tissues around the bite site. But there should be, and blister fluid in case of the venom, because it gives that area gangrene. So it is easy.